Hello and welcome everyone. I'm sorry, last time I was not able to upload the video because I was having a bit longer engagements. As such, from now on, the videos will be posted on Sunday itself and Sunday morning by or before 9 o'clock because I have some prior appointments to it. So I would like to apologize on that part. And today we are continuing element 5, industrial hygiene and occupational health. And to your surprise, this element is requiring a lot of research. So today the topic that we are going to cover is occupational exposure limits. So now, as you all know, that these videos are part of the national training program that we have developed. But yes, there are five core different sub parts to this element, and that is industrial hygiene and occupational health and overview, which we took the last video. So today we'll be talking on occupational exposure limits. Then after that it is toxicology and workplace monitoring, and finally statutory provision related to industrial hygiene. So I would most likely not be covering the other two topics, and we'll be straight away in next video going to statutory provisions. Now let us see what is there in today's video, and that is about OEL, that is occupational exposure limits. So when we actually try and understand the main task of an occupational hygiene is to protect the health and working population. Among the first practical measures is determine of any dangerous or harmful toxic substances in the atmosphere of work environment. After determination of the present concentration at given workplace, next natural steps must be evaluation of the obtained result against a national or international exposure limit standard. Now, permissible level of chemical substances in work environment. So what are those? The exposure limits related to pollution of workplace environment should safeguard the health as it was defined in the Constitution of World Organization as a state of complete physical and mental and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease or infirmity. The usefulness of the concept of exposure limits of toxic agents in the work environment has been adequately demonstrated in many practical situations in which there has been a significant reduction or disappearance of occupational diseases after adequate applications of these limits. Now, permissible level or limits has been defined in, we have discussed in as per ILO, as per WHO documents, and as per quantitative hygienic standards for a level of level considered to be safe, and expressed as concentration with a defined average time. So primarily when we are talking about exposures, the term permissible level for occupational exposure can also be taken to mean or maximum allowable concentration. So it can mean maximum allowable concentration or threshold limit value, that is TLV. So mostly you will come across these words, that it, whether it is MAC or whether it is TLV, so that you need to consider. At present, a term exposure limit is recommended. Presently what we are discussing, exposure limits. Now exposure limits can be maximum allowable concentration or threshold limit value, TLV. Correct. So by ILO, for chemical substances in work environment, all method values of standard represent a workplace environment limit at time average concentration of toxic substances in the air under which nearly all workers may be exposed repeatedly or normal work day over a work life or time without adverse effect. Now these values are based on best available information from the industrial experience and the experimental studies. it is necessary to add that small percentage of workers may experience, you know, discomfort from some chemicals, and smaller percentage may be affected more seriously by aggravated or aggravated percentage or pre-existing condition or by development of occupational illness at concentrations at or below the limits. The general exposure limit, that is TWA, may be exceeded. This is basically time work average, what we are talking about. So it may exceed for a short period without any injury to the health. So primarily, whenever we say that, okay, nothing has happened to me since long, but that is because the exposure has been limited. Now, when the exposure level increases to a greater level, you will definitely get the exposure, and that can result into some more critical illnesses or may cause harm. So what are the factors? So but the limitations to this is depending on the some factors. So what are those factors? Let us quickly have a review of that. So first, whether or not the containment is highly toxic or highly irritating agent. So this is the very first aspect that you need to consider, whether the anything existing in the atmosphere is highly toxic or it is highly irritating agent. So you will only have effect when it is at a higher level, but that doesn't mean that it is not toxic. If the level of exposure is constant, continuously every day you are getting exposed, so slowly and gradually it will cause harm, and that can lead to occupational illness. Now, the second factor is whether or not its effects are cumulative. So whether or not, you have to understand, so if you're working in a fibrous environment or where fibers are there, so the exposure takes time. So when it is cumulative, when at a gradual course of time the exposure was high, so slowly and gradually you develop the effects. Now the third aspect is frequency at which higher concentration occur. So at which frequency, what was the frequency of your exposure? So that is to be decided. Now during such period of high duration, primarily, so what was the duration of or the period of high concentration exposure? So it is like somebody is just opening a manhole, correct, just to have a peek on what is happening inside, but that again result into an higher concentration exposure. May the duration will be very minimal, but the concentration is high, so that will also affect. And finally, the likelihood of acute poisoning resulting from high concentration. So what are the likelihood that when higher concentration or acute poisoning occurs? So what it occurs at higher concentration. Now let us start with some basic definitions which you need to understand when it comes to occupational exposure limits. So the TLVs, that is threshold limit values. So first we will start with TLVs. What is threshold limit values? So the TLVs are guidelines to be used by professional industrial hygienist. The values presented are intended for use only as guidelines or recommendations to assist in the evaluation and control of potential workplace hazards, and for no other use, neither for evaluating or controlling or community air pollution for the estimated toxic potentials or of continuous uninterrupted exposures or other extended work periods for providing or disapproving an existing disease or physical condition of an individual. Further, these values are not fine lines between safe and dangerous conditions. So these are just evaluations. They are just measures that we are trying to measure something out. And lastly, you should not use anyone who is not trained in the discipline of industrial hygienists. So the TLVs are not regulatory or just standard conditions. So there is nothing like the standard condition exists. No. Now it is when we are talking about the exposure levels, so you must understand that when we say that exposure levels, so that exposure level, maybe, you know, it is good for you, but it is not good for others. Maybe it is, you know, some people have you can resistance, but some people don't. So you cannot say that, okay, this much exposure is okay. No, it is not so. So you need to first understand that whenever we are talking of exposures, whenever the assessments are done related to the personal health monitoring or personal monitoring, so these are just measures that where, okay, the exposure is happening, but that doesn't mean that exposure can happen, you know. There is not a, okay, this much is acceptable. No, nothing is acceptable, because anything and everything, may it be the exposure time is less, but that doesn't mean that we should allow the constant exposure. So the exposure should not happen, because like we discuss that when you know, whenever any person is coming to the industry, so what does the definition says? State of complete physical, mental and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease. Correct. So this is what safety is all about. So when we talk of all these aspects, we must take care of these specific limits. Now let us discuss that threshold limit values. The DLVs refer to the airborne concentration of chemical substances and represents conditions under which it is believed that nearly all the workers may be repeatedly exposed day after day over the working limits without adverse health effect. So this is very important, that we must understand without any adverse health effect. So whenever we are looking at any exposure, so it should not impact the health of the individual. Now chemical substances with equivalent TLVs, that is same numerical values, cannot be assumed to be having same toxicological effect or similar biologic potencies. Now TLVs of each chemical substance, that is airborne concentration in part per million, that is ppm, or milligrams per cubic meter, that is mg per meter cube, are critical effects produced by chemical substances. Now these critical effects from the forms the basis of the TLV. Although TLV refers as airborne levels of chemical exposure, you know, but the exposures may possibly occur in a workplace. Now the three categories, we must discuss the three categories. So there are three categories of TLVs as specified, that is time weight average, TWA. Now what is TWA? This is short term and time weight average. The second aspect is short term exposure limits, that is STEL, and you know, a ceiling for most substances. A TWA alone or with STEL, that is short term exposure limits, is relevant. For some substances that are irritant gas, only the TLVC, that is the ceiling or the concentration level, is applicable. If any of these TLV types are exceeded, a potential hazard from the substance is presumed to exist. Now let us start discussing threshold limit value, weight average, correct? So it is TLV, TWA. So the TWA concentration for a conventional 8-hour work and a 40-hour work week, to which it is believed that nearly all the workers may be repeatedly exposed day after day for a working lifetime without an adverse effect. Although calculating the average concentration of work, work week rather than a work day may be appropriate in some instances. Though ACGIH, that is American Council of, you know, General Industrial Hygiene, so does not offer guidelines regarding to such exposures. So you have to understand that when we talk of time weight average, so what is the average duration that a person is getting exposure? So we are just taking a day exposure levels, and we cannot predict that the day, if we have just monitored a day, you know, exposure level, it will be same for the entire week. So it may differ, it may be high, it may be low. So the highest level of exposure to the lowest level of exposure, if we take a mean value out of it, and then we derive that, okay, this much exposure has to happen. So when we are considering the upper limits, so what we need to consider, we need to consider that, okay, the exposure will be high for the entire week. And it is not that we just have 40 hours of working in a week. We can have more also. So you imagine the level of exposure will also increase. Now let us discuss threshold limit value and short term exposure limits. In 15 minutes, like TWA, exposure that should not exceed at any time duration of workplace, even if 8 hour TWA is within the TLV TWA, the TLV STEL, that is short term exposure limit, is the concentration to which it is believed that the worker can be exposed continuously for a short period of time without suffering from one, irritant, or second, chronic or irreversible tissue damages. Now third, the dosage rate depends on toxic effect. And fourth, narcosis or the significant degree to increase the likelihood of accidental injuries. Now the impact of self rescue, or mainly the reduced work efficiency, the TLV will not necessarily protect against these effects. If daily TLV and TWA is exceeding, the TLV STEL usually supplements the TWA where there are recognizable acute effects from substances whose toxic effects are primarily of a chronic nature. Now, however, the TLV STEL may be a separate independent exposure guide. Exposures above the TLV TWA where there are recognized acute effects from the substances whose toxic effects are primarily of a chronic nature, however, the TLVs may be independent exposure guidelines. So exposure above the TLV TWA up to the TLV STEL should be less than 15 minutes and should not occur no more than 4 times per day, and there should be at least 60 minutes between the successive exposure in this range. An average period other than 15 minutes may be recommended when this is warranted by the observed biological effects. So primarily when we talk of TLV and TLV TWA and TLV STEL, so the short term exposure level and the average time weight average, it is considered. And short term exposure level is only considered to be okay, this much level up to 15 minutes and for 8 hours. So how much is the what is the peak that has been reached? So like we discussed earlier, that whatever are the peaks, based on that the average duration is considered. Now short term exposure limits primarily are focusing on the more highly irritant or chronic effects of chemicals are there. So for those chemicals, STEL is considered. Now let us discuss threshold limit value ceiling or the concentration. So the concentration, that is C, TLVC. So the concentration should not be exceeding during any part of the work exposure. If instantaneous measures are not available, like sampling should be conducted for a minimum period of time. Sufficient or detective exposures of above ceiling values or concentration value should be taken. So ACGIH, that is American Conference of Government Industrial Hygienist, believes that TLV based on physical irritations should be considered no less binding than those based on physical impairments. So there is an increase in evidence that physical irritation may irritate or promote or accelerate the adverse health effect through interaction with other chemicals and biological agents. So these are the main criterias behind, or these are the main definitions of these three points. Now let us discuss emergency response planning guide. So when it comes to emergency response planning guide, what are the things that we need to consider? So emergency response planning guide are in short been given name as ERPGs. So they are intended to be used by person trained in emergency response planning as planning to tools for assessing the adequacy of the independent prevention and containment measures under the chemical release for transportation emergency planning and for developing facility, site and community emergency response plan. So the labels are not to be used to determine safe limits for routine operations, as you know, definitely there is a small line, thin line between the safe and unsafe exposure conditions, or as a basis of quantitative risk assessment. Now these limit emergency response planning guides are mainly for if something happens, you know, accidentally. So it is for that. So it doesn't form, you know, any working base. So that is why ERPG's label are very different than your existing labels, correct? So let us understand what is ERPG-1. So ERPG-1 is the maximum airborne concentration below which it is believed nearly all individuals could be exposed for up to 1 hour without experiences more than mild, you know, transient or adverse health effect, or without perceiving a clearly defined objectionable order. So that is ERPG-1. What is ERPG-2? The maximum airborne concentration below which it is believed nearly all individuals could be exposed for up to 1 hour without experiencing or developing irritable or other serious health effect or symptoms that could impair an individual ability to take protective action. So this is number 2. The third, so here the levels are increasing. Now the third is the maximum airborne concentration below which it is believed that early all individuals would be exposed for up to 1 hour without experiencing or developing any life-threatening health effects. So this is, these are the three, you know, okay, the mild effect will be there, you know, then first is mild effect will be there or no effect will be there. Second is it will definitely create, you know, serious health effect, and finally it is bound that it will create life-threatening health effects, correct? So this is ERPG 1, 2 and 3. So these are the labels that are required to be defined when it comes to emergency response planning guide. Now using the application emergency response planning program, generally individual accident release scenarios in which air dispersion model that is determined the concentration of isoplates that is programmed designed to protect the public from transportation incidents involving chemical materials, also known as ERPG's values, also are important for compliance with the US Environment Protection Agency's, that is EPA, and Emergency Planning and Community Rights to Work, that is EPCRA. Now those who are ERPG values include community emergency planners, emergency responders, air dispersion modelers, industrial process safety engineers, community action and emergency response, that is CAER participants, local emergency planning coordinators, that is LEPCS, and state emergency response commissions, that is SERCS, industrial hygienists, toxicologists, transportation safety engineers, fire protection specialists, government agencies, risk assessors and risk manager, resource conservation and recovery act, that is RCRA managers. So ERPGs can be used with dispersion models together with other information such as inventory, storage volumes and atmospheric conditions to provide computerized estimates of the potential spread and airborne concentration in case of release. From these estimates, actions can be planned and can be developed. Now the plan may vary for any given emergency depending on such as what is the pollution population density, whether there are school or elderly near about, you know, whether the condition of the nature, whether it is just going to impact the, you know, environment, using estimated release rate, the physical and chemical properties of those products released, and meteorological data. The dispersion modeling methods generate estimated distance and time of arrival for ERPG concentrations. So you have to understand that ERPGs primarily focuses on only one thing, that okay, in case of extreme emergencies, what is going to happen, how much distance the, you know, things are going to travel, how much area will be exposed. So this when you know, and why these dispersion models are taken into consideration, that you should know, like if I you know, want to name it, so it is basically the QRA, quantitative risk exposure assessment, where, you know, when we just prepare a model that okay, this much amount of concentrated material is stored in a tanker, or it has been filled and it is traveling from this route, so based on the wind condition, so how much area can be impacted, so the entire authorities surrounding that area are alerted that okay, we are carrying this is the route, if anything happens, so you should be prepared. So they are always on a high alert that if any toxic substances been, you know, traveling from here and there. So this is what happens, you know, all the agencies, they keep a track of certain chemicals. Now we believe that oh, this is not practically possible, but no, it is happening, and there is a reason why organizations, or you know, there are so many institutions that you know, actually monitor and take care of all these things. So there are different departments and, you know, wings of state and central bodies which actually keep a track on all these things. And the more we assess all these conditions, will be better for future, so that we make the environment and the transportation safe. So I hope you have liked the video by now. If you have liked the video, you have, you know, already hit the like button, you have shared it, and please keep on subscribing. We you know, really want to connect with more and more amount of people. And thank you so much, friends, and keep writing to us, and we'll be posting some more videos on this, and we'll be covering statutory next. So thank you so much, friends.